Bwana asifiwe. This morning I want to speak on the love of God. You know, when the Sunday school were saying the memory verse, and I heard them, you know, talk about the love of God, I knew that this is what God wanted me to speak this morning. So I want to speak about the unconditional love of God. I was reading this week, I think this week or last week, and I read from the Facebook a statement that really blessed my soul. I've been meditating on it, and the author said that one of the greatest causes of low self-esteem is lack of unconditional love. That the reason why people struggle with low self-esteem is because they have not received unconditional love. They have been loved by people, but the love was attached to some conditions. I will love you if you do this. If you perform well, I'm happy with you, I love you. But if you don't perform well, then my love may not be that much. So he said that one of the greatest causes of people having low self-esteem is not receiving unconditional love. But God gives us unconditional love. The love of God is not attached to anything. He loves us just the way we are. Not because of something good we have done, not of something good that we will do, but he loves us because he is love. The Bible says God is love. And one thing about love is that love cannot help but just love. And that's why he created us in his own image, because love cannot be complete without an object that it is directed toward. Love, for love to be complete, it must have an object or a person that it is directed to, that can receive the love. And that's why God had to create us in his own image. And that's why he could visit the man in the cool of day and they would fellowship, because love, like giving itself out and also being given back. And that's why, you know, God desires fellowship with us. You know, when I come, I work out of Nairobi. And when I come back on Friday sometimes, when my daughters, you know, learn to me and, you know, embrace me, you know, as a dad, I feel good. So sometimes I think, when I don't go to my God, you know, to tell him I love him, I want to fellowship with you, how does he feel? I feel so good when my daughters come to me as their father and they, you know, I embrace them and I love them. How does God feel when I don't go back to him to give back the love? Because one thing about love is when it is given, it also wants to receive back. It wants that the object that is receiving it love also is giving it back by coming back, you know, to have a fellowship. So God is love and he cannot do without us coming together and having that relationship with of love. When you know that God loves you with an infinite, unconditional, and unchanging love, you have security inside you that no person can take away. When you know that God loves me, no matter what, he loves me with unchanging love. It doesn't depend on my performance. God does not love me more when I read 5 chapters in the morning. And tomorrow if I read 2, he will not love me more. His love is not dependent on me. Because one thing about the unconditional love, it does not so much depend on who is receiving it, but on who is giving it. And because God is love, he does not so much depend on what I do, but because of who he is. So he gave it to me, not because of my performance, but because of who he is. So this morning, if we can come to that place where we have that security that God loves me no matter what, then we can have security that cannot be shaken. You have the kind of self-value and self-esteem that is based on the way God values and esteems you. When we see ourselves the way God esteems us, the way God loves us, then we cannot be shaken. People may come into our lives and leave, but that will not shake us, because our security was not in their love. Our security was in the love of God. Because people will always come in our lives, and some will stay forever, but some for a season. And sometimes it can be frustrating when a person you valued or you depended on come, you know, go out of your life. But when you know that your love, your primary source of love is in God, even when everybody else walk out of your life, you can still stand still and wait on God. Because he never changes. His love is constant. Regardless of what you are going through, he is ever loving. He is ever caring. You find a place in the love of God, you will find a place in the heart of those God put in your life. If you can find that place in God, loving others cannot be hard. If you are grounded in the love of God, then even loving those that God brings you away, it cannot be hard. But as long as you are not establishing that love, that God loves me, when I wake up in the morning, you know, when talking about Jesus, when he was baptized, the Bible says, you know, the Holy Spirit, you know, came upon him. And God said, this is my son in whom I'm well pleased. Had Jesus done anything? He was just baptized. He had not done any miracle. But God said, this is my son in whom I'm well pleased. So from that point, even when as Jesus ministered, his ministry was not the source of his confidence. His confidence, the miracles or anything else, was not what was giving him confidence. But his confidence was coming from the love that he has with the Father, the connection that he had with the Father. So even when people received him or they didn't receive him, it didn't mean much to him. Because his confidence and his grounding was in the love of God. God had already said that I'm well pleased with you. Even before he did any miracle, even before he preached to anyone, God was well pleased with him. So his foundation and his grounding was on that statement. Love motivates God's every action. God, you know, God is love. And every action that God does is motivated by love. Giving his son, as the Sunday school said, but God so loved the world that he gave his begotten son. Every move that God makes is motivated by love. Lead from Genesis all the way to Revelation. Everything that God does is motivated by love because he is love. Every action directs his activities and reflects his desire. The unconditional love does not mean that God loves everything we do, but rather his love is so intense that he loves every sinner. The unconditional love of God does not mean that God loves everything we do, but rather his love is so intense that he loves every sinner. It is not that sometimes he's pleased with everything that we do, but because of his nature, he loves every sinner. The Bible says that he is not happy. He wants everybody to come to the knowledge of the living God. The character of the Father is love. God is love. The character of the Son is grace. The Bible says that law was given through Moses, but truth and grace came through Christ. So the nature of the Son is grace, and he came through grace. And the nature of the character of the Holy Spirit is fellowship. And that's why he helped us to fellowship with the Father. We can only be free and fully who we are, or what God created us to be, when we understand the heart of the Father, which is the heart of love. If we can understand the heart of the Father, which is the heart of love, then we can be fully who we are. Because we will have security, we will have freedom, we will have confidence and boldness to move, because we know who we are. So I wanted to look at the nature of the unconditional love of the Father. The nature, if you want to give my message title, the nature of unconditional love of the Father. One of the things is that it relates with its object or recipient by grace. The love of the Father, one of the nature of the unconditional love of the Father is that it relates with its object or recipient by grace. Grace means that I don't deserve it, I have not earned it, I have not merited it, but he just gives us. Salvation is a gift. We never earned it. We never worked for it. We received it by grace. The Bible says we are saved by grace through faith. So one of the ways that unconditional love relates with its object is through grace. It relates with the object through grace. The first time the word grace is used is in Genesis 6:8 in the Bible. The Bible says, but Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. When God was about to destroy the earth, the Bible says Noah found grace. Not that he deserved it than anybody else, but he found grace. That is the first time the word grace is used in the Bible. So when God was destroying the earth with water, Noah found grace in the sight of God. And because of that, he was saved with his family and with everything he did. He found favor, and that's why he was not destroyed. The law was, as we have mentioned, that the law was given through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus. So grace is able to save us. I want us to look at the woman with the issue of the blood. I will request the media team to give us John 8, verse 3. If you can give me the NIV, I would appreciate. This is a reading. The Bible says, the teacher of the law and the Pharisee brought in a woman caught in adultery. They made her stand before the group, verse 4, and said to Jesus, "Teacher, this woman was caught in the act of adultery. In the law of Moses, commanded us to stone such a woman, Now, what do you say?" That is the story of, we all know the story of this old lady that was caught in adultery. I'll request the team to give us verse 10 and 11. Jump to verse 10. The Bible says, "Jesus straightened up and asked her, 'Woman, where are they that has no, where are they? Has no one condemned you?'" And verse 11, "No one, sir," she said. "Then neither do I condemn you." Jesus declared, "Go now and live your life of sin." This is the lady that was brought by men before Jesus. The Bible says that she was caught in the act of adultery. And according to the law, she was supposed to be stoned to death. So they brought her to Jesus and asked Jesus, "Now, what do you say about her? What should we do about it?" The Bible, if you read verse 6, 7, 8, and 9, the Bible says that Jesus wrote on the ground and they started leaving. The men that had brought her started leaving one by one until Jesus was left with a lady. And that's when Jesus asked her. Jesus straightened up and asked her, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" "No, sir," she said. "Then neither do I condemn you." Jesus declared, "Go now and live your life of sin." The teachers of the law had condemned her, but grace did not condemn her. Because the nature of the love of God is relating to us by grace. She deserved, according to the law of Moses, she was supposed to be stoned. But she was not stoned because she was not relating to the law. She was relating to the grace. The law, the sentence of the law, or she had received a sentence of death from the teachers of the law. When they brought her to Jesus, the condemnation or the sentence was supposed to be death by stoning. But because she met grace, she received a gift of no condemnation from the teacher of grace. When we come to the teacher of grace, when we come to the gospel, we don't receive a message of condemnation. She had been condemned. Her destiny had been sealed, that you are supposed to be stoned to death. But when she was brought to Jesus, Jesus said, "I do not condemn you also." One thing about the grace is that grace does not condemn us. It is easier for, you know, in life, it is very easier for us to condemn others, especially in our areas of strength. Where I am not weak, when I say you failing in that area, I can easily condemn you. I wonder, why are you failing in this area? Because I'm strong in that. But in my area of weakness, I don't want anybody to touch me in that area. But Jesus looked at that lady and forgave her. She never condemned her. One thing about giving the gift of no condemnation, if you read what Jesus said, "Go now and live your life of sin." The only way that lady could go and live a clean life is not being condemned. As long as she was condemned, she continue living that. Every person who feels unworthy, they will always behave in an unworthy manner. But the moment you receive the grace of God, the love of God, and you feel that you are worthy, then you cannot behave in a certain manner. When you feel that you are loved, when you feel that God so loves you and he so care about you, there are things that you cannot do because of your worth. But as long as somebody is condemned, as long as somebody is walking in guilty, they will behave in an unworthy manner. As long as you feel that you are not worthy, And one of the greatest secrets of the enemy is to make people walk in guilt and condemnation. Because as long as I'm walking in guilt and condemnation, I will never be able to overcome my habit, the bad habits that I'm struggling with, and my guilt. One, because I will not approach the throne of grace. I will run away from God instead of going to God. Because when I'm guilty, I feel that I don't qualify to go into the presence of God. So instead of coming to God, I will run away. But my help is with God. So the only place that I can get my deliverance, the only place that I can get my healing is in his presence. But guilt and condemnation always drive people away from God. They don't want to fellowship with God. They don't want to fellowship with other brethren. They keep away from church. They keep away from fellowship. So Jesus gave her a gift of no condemnation. As long as we receive a gift of no condemnation, we can conquer every area of our lives. Because God, the grace of God. You know, Paul was told by God, you know, the Bible says that Paul was struggling. He had a thorn in his flesh. And he went to God a number of times. And the Bible says that God told him, My grace, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. When you know that the grace of God can help you in even in your area of weakness, then you will not run away from God. You will learn to him. And how can you learn to him? When you know that his heart is full of love. He is not condemning you. He wants to help you. He wants to lift you. His plans for you has not changed. He's still full of love. He's still full of mercy. And he wants you to take you to the great life, greater level. He wants you to walk in victory. Because that's the desire of the heart of God. Love always desires the best for the object that it is directed to. When somebody loves you, when your parents love you, they sacrifice so that you can go higher than they have gone. They will educate you because they want you to have a better life than they have. That's the same heart of God. He wants his children to enjoy the best. But as long as somebody is walking in condemnation, they will not approach God. They will run away. And the enemy will keep them in a cycle of victory and defeat. For 1 week you are walking in victory. Then maybe something happened and the condemnation and guilt come in. You run away from God. But if you can learn that even when I blow it up, God still loves me. His love is not based on my performance. His love is based on who he is. I can still go to him. He will still embrace me. He will still love me. He will still watch me. And he will still set me in my direction. You will be able to go to him and he will be able to give you strength. He will be able to give you grace to overcome every challenge. The only way a brother or a sister who has fallen into sin can stop sinning and walk in victory is by receiving the gift of no condemnation. When Jesus gave her the gift of no condemnation, she told her, go now and live your life of sin. Why? Because she has received the power not to sin. The power not to sin is the grace of God. That I'm loved. I am accepted. He cares and he thinks well about us. Because the Bible says in Titus chapter 2, 11, 12. Titus chapter 2, verse 11 and 12. For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness, verse 12, and to worldly passion, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age. When we approach the throne of grace, we receive the grace of God. And the grace of God is a teacher. He teaches us to say no to ungodliness. The grace of God is not a license to live in sin. The grace of God is a license to live a life of righteousness. It is the power of God to walk victoriously. When we receive the grace of God, when we receive the gift of no condemnation, we can be able to overcome every obstacle in our way. Grace empowers us and teaches us to say no to ungodliness. Romans 6:14 says, for sin shall not be your master, because you are not under the law, but under grace. For sin shall not be your master, because you are not under the law, but under grace. The only way you can overcome sin, the only way that sin cannot be a master is when we are under the grace of God. When we know the heart of Father, the heart of love, and that he relates with us by the grace, we can be able to overcome every obstacle. The example, there is a story I read that really blessed my soul. There is this young man in America. He got his license and, you know, he was excited. He wanted to drive and he took a vehicle. And, you know, he drove very fast and he caused an accident. And a very old man came and helped him, took him home. And, you know, after that, everything, he was booked. So about after 2 weeks, he went to court for the mention of his case. And when he stood, he saw that the same old man who had helped him was the judge. So he thought, now this is my friend. So everything is going to be well. So the case was led to him, and the judge judged him that as guilty. And the young man was disappointed. I thought you are my friend. You helped me, and now you have said that I'm guilty. I caused an accident. The young man was fined. He didn't have the money. So he was taken to cell, ready to be taken to the prison. But after the judge was through with the case, he went and paid the fine. And the young man asked, who has paid my fine? And he was told, the judge has paid the fine. So the young man went looking for the judge. And he looked at him and wondered, what kind of a man are you? You have judged me. I thought you'd forgive me. Now you have judged me, then you have paid the fine for me. But the judge looked at him and told him, I had to follow the law. Do you think that that young man would go and repeat the same mistake? When we receive the grace of God, when we receive the love of God, we cannot go out and do some things. When we understand the love of the Father, the heart of the Father, we cannot go out and repeat the same mistake. Because now the judge and a young man were afraid, I don't think that young man would go out and repeat the same mistake, or he would ever want to stand before that judge because of anything wrong. So the moment we understand the heart of the Father, we want to go him because we love him, because of fellowship, because we know he cares for us, and he's able to go out of the way. The second thing I want us to look at is the unconditional love keep no record of wrong committed to it. The second thing about the unconditional love of God, it keep no record of wrong committed to it. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, 5. Part B, the Bible says, maybe I can read the whole First Corinthians 13, 5. It is talking about love. It is not rude. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. It keeps no record of wrong. When God forgives, he forgets. When God forgives me, when I go to him, when I have done something that have hurt his heart, and I go and, you know, I ask for forgiveness, he forgets about it. He does not keep a record of wrong because God is love. And the Bible clearly says it keeps no record of wrong. So when I go to God, he has no merit list based on my performance. When I go in prayer, he doesn't look, how many times have you breathed this week? How many times have you not done the right thing this week? He has no merit list because he's love, and love does not keep a record of wrong. When I go before him, he embraces me as father. He embraces me with a heart of love, and he's happy that his son has come back. You know, when we were young, we were taught that, you know, when you do well, from very young, that when I do well, my dad is very happy with me, my mom is very happy with me. But if I do a mistake, then the opposite may be true. I may receive a number of caning, or the mood may not be as good as it was. So from when we are very young, we know we are always reminded. And if when I repeat the same mistake, I can maybe do a mistake on Monday, and the whole thing is solved. But if I do a mistake on Saturday, I'll be reminded of what I did on Monday. That's the nature of man. And sometimes when we go to God, we tend to think, what I did on Monday, he's still remembering. But when we go to him, if he has forgiven us, he has no record. It is as if that thing never happened. And he's full of love. We were trained from very young that there is a record of all that you have done. And when I come on Saturday, I want something, I can be reminded. You don't deserve this thing. You remember what you did on Monday? You remember what you did on Tuesday? So I'm not going to give you. Try to be a better boy next week. Then we see by Saturday, maybe you receive the gift. But that is not our God. He has no merit card. He has a grace card. That when he forgives us, he releases us. And he wants us to come to back to him because he is full of love. I want us to look at the story of the prodigal son. In Luke 15, because it clearly shows that the father never kept a merit card with the son. Luke chapter 15, verse 18 and 19. We will not read the whole story because of time. Luke 15, 18 and 19. The Bible says, this is the prodigal son, after asking the father for his inheritance, going away and wasting it. Then the Bible says he came back to his senses, and that's what he said to himself. Have you set out? He said, and the father also said, amen. Have you set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. And verse 19, I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men. Maybe verse 22. We see what happened when. But the father said to his servant, quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. When he arrived home, he had prepared, he had rehearsed what he is going to tell the father. He had prepared a speech. And he was going to tell the father, I am not worthy to be called your son. I have sinned against you. I have sinned against heaven. So I don't qualify to be your son. I qualify to be your servant because I have taken my portion and I have used it all. But the Bible says when he arrived home, when he started giving the speech, father interrupted the speech. In fact, he gave the first part where he said, I have sinned against you and I have sinned against heaven. The father never allowed him to say that I'm not worthy to be called your son. That is the part that the father could not allow. He couldn't hear that from his son, that his son was not worthy to be called his son. He interrupted this. The Bible says, but the father said to his servant, quick, bring the best robe and put on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. The father had not kept a scorecard for his son. He had a grace card. The moment the son left, the father was longing and waiting for the son to come back because his heart was full of love. He didn't keep the record of all that he had done. But he was waiting for him to come back because his heart was full of love. The father had forgotten all the son had done and was willing to restore him to his former position and even celebrate his coming back. Not was only the restoration because he was clothed with the best robe, meaning that he was restored as a son. He was given the ring that signified the sonship that he was in the family. He was given his sandals. But not only was that, but there was also a celebration because the son had come back home. That's the father of love. That's the heart of the father. The heart of love. He does not keep a record of the wrongs that is committed to it. When God forgives us, he forgets about it. He is free and he does not take. Do you think that this son would run away from home again? When you experience the heart of the father, you cannot run away. There is a lesson he learned about the love of the father. There is something he understood about the heart of the father that the elder brother could not understand. And that's why the elder brother could not understand the whole thing. Because he was a brother, he was not a father. So to him, the son, to him, he deserved to receive the punishment. He has messed it up. And that's why sometimes we behave in the church. When somebody has brewed it up, We are quick to judge them. We are quick to say that they deserve this. But the father is saying, this is my son. Come back home. We may not understand why the father is forgiving him, because he is our brother, he is our sister. But the father understands. He knows the price that was paid for that son and the price that was paid for that daughter. So he is willing to receive them back, to wash them, to clothe them with the robe of righteousness, and to restore their possession in the house, because he understands the price that was paid for them. The father understands the price. Sometimes the brothers and sisters may not understand the price that was paid for the son or for the daughter, but God understood it. So let us not be so quick to judge others. In fact, the Bible says, don't judge and you not be judged, because you don't know how the father is dealing with the daughter or with the son. Give them time. Let the father deal with the daughter. Let the father deal with the son, because he is dealing them with a deeper understanding. He is dealing them with a heart of love. We may deal with them with a heart of wisdom, with a heart of understanding, you know, and with a heart of correction. But if the father is dealing with them with a heart of love, and sometimes, you know, we only see the struggle that they are going through. We may not understand where they are coming from. They could be struggling now, but where God has taken them from and where they are, there is a rejoicing in heaven, because there is victory, there is breakthrough coming through. But we are seeing the struggles that they are there. But when God looks at it, he is celebrating that my son is making it up. My son is moving on. My son will make it up. My son will have a breakthrough. So let's not judge them. Let's pray for them. Let's encourage them, because that is the heart of the father, to restore the son with a lot of love. So even as we correct, even as we, you know, we rebuke, let's ask God to help us to rebuke and to correct with the heart of the father, which is the heart of love. And lastly, I want us to look at the third thing. The unconditional love of the father always gives a second chance to a recipient. The unconditional love of God or the father always gives a second chance to a recipient. I want us to read from 1 John 2 and verse 1. 1 John 2. The Bible says, my dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin. But if anybody does sin, we have one who speaks to the Father in our defense, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. Verse 2. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sin, and not only for our sin, but also for the sin of the whole world. I like the tense. You know, Pastor Monio taught me about the tenses last Sunday. The Bible says, he is the atoning, the atoning. The Bible does not say he was the atoning. Even now, he is the atoning sacrifice of our sin. So that when we go to the Father, the Bible says that, my dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin. But if anybody does sin, we have one who speaks to the Father in our defense. And then he says that he is our atoning sacrifice. Not that he was, but even in this moment, he is our atoning sacrifice. He is still speaking to the Father about us. He is our defense. You know that term, you know, he is our defense. Those are legal terms, meaning that he's standing before the throne of God as a lawyer, and he's telling the Father, give him another chance. Because of what I went through the cross, because of my sacrifice on the cross, give him another chance. I will wash him. I know he can make it. He is our atoning sacrifice this morning. So it doesn't matter whether you have blown it. You could have walked away from the love of God, but there is an atoning sacrifice this morning. You can come back to him. You don't have to run away from him. There is a defense lawyer in the presence of the Father this morning, who is speaking good about us. He's not condemning us. He's speaking love to the Father. He's speaking victory on our behalf. You know, the Bible says that he ever liveth to make intercession for us. And sometimes when I'm not able to pray, I sit and, you know, I say, I know there is one who is making intercession for me. Even when I'm weak and I cannot pray, even when I'm going through challenges, I don't know which way, I know there is one interceding for us. And this morning, he's also a defense lawyer in the presence of God on behalf of every child of God. So he's speaking on our behalf. The Bible also says that love covers a multitude of sin. And because God is love, he covers a multitude of sin. He's able to deal with us at our own level. And he's able to bring us and to make us grow as we depend on his love. So this morning, the unconditional love of God is not condemning anyone. He's open. He's full of his love. He wants the best out of us. One of the my desire is to see my son and my daughters becoming that all that God has made them to be. I pray that they can know their purpose earlier than I have known. That they can know what God created them to be. And they can walk in that. And if that's my desire and I'm limited, how about our God? He is desiring that we can know our purpose in life. That we can follow him. That we can understand his love. You know, his love and the great thing that he has in store for us, and we can walk in them because that's the desire of the Father. Fathers always desire that their sons and daughter can go further than they have gone themselves, that they can achieve more than they have achieved more. God desires us that we can accomplish our commission and our destiny here on earth. That's the heart of the Father this morning. He is desiring that we can walk in his love. He is desiring that we can know him, that he loves us with an everlasting love. Romans 6:8 says, but God demonstrated his own love for us in this, where we were still sinner, Christ died for us. But God demonstrated his own love for us in this, where we were still sinners, Christ died for us. You know, to demonstrate is to make it so clear. You know, when you are teaching and you are giving a demonstration, you want it to make it so clear that the student will never forget about it. So the death of Christ is the demonstration of God's love. He tells us, if you can remember the Calvary cost, then you can know how much I love you this morning. If you can remember the price I paid on Calvary, if you can remember Calvary, then you can know my heart for you. You can know how much I loved you. 1 John 4:9-10 says, this is now how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only son into the world that we may live through him. This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son as an atoning sacrifice for our sin. This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us. That is the love of God. When we were on our own ways, when we were rebelling against him, when we didn't care about the word of God, that's when he sent his son, that he can die for us. And the Bible says that if Christ then justified us, then how about us? If he loved us when we were out there, now how about when we are in the house? If he loved us when we were walking in rebellion, if he loved us when we didn't love him, how about now that we acknowledge him? And every day we are desiring to honor him. Then it means there is nothing that, and that's why the Bible says in Romans, that there is nothing that can separate us from his love. If we can understand his love, if we can understand his heart, then there is nothing that can separate us from his love. Because it is so deep. It is not dependent on what I do, but it is dependent on who he is. He is willing to extend it this morning, and we can receive the love of God. Bonasifue. I don't know where you are this morning, but God is saying, I love you. The plans I have for you are plans of good and not evil. My heart is full of love. I desire good for you. Maybe you are there, you don't know him. This is an opportunity to receive the love of the Father. Because this is the greatest thing that you can ever receive. The love of the Father. Because you'll never be secure. You'll never be all that God created you to be without that, you know, firm foundation of knowing that when I wake up in the morning, there is one in heaven who is not judging me but loving me, who cares so much about my life and who wants the best for me. I will request that we stand on our feet. And just think about your life. If you are there and you have not given your life to Christ, he's open. His heart is full of love. Like the father of the prodigal son, the Bible says that when the father saw him, he learned to meet him. Meaning that the father was studying somewhere, waiting and longing for the son to come back. Because the heart of the father knew that the son would go and he would come back home. That the father knew that. I want to give back to our dad.